just going to, you know, share very briefly this evening on some basic reminders. And the whole idea, you know, the reason we gather here day after day so faithfully is because it is the Lord who's drawing us into his presence. So this evening, as we speak on the importance of intercession as a ministry, let's remind ourselves who we are, why we are here. And the reason we are here is because Jesus is the eternal high priest. Brothers and sisters, an intercession is our great privilege and an awesome responsibility for each one of us to be able to share in this ministry of Jesus, the eternal high priest. Okay? And we are not just doing it in our own power, in our own ability. We are standing here every time we come in this time of intercession. When we come to intercede, we are coming in the name of Jesus. We are coming with the heart of Jesus. We are coming with the mind of Jesus. And that is why it is very important for us to pray for the will of God in every situation. And we are here primarily to pray for others. Intercession is a time to intercede, to pray for others, to stand with Christ Jesus, who has filled the gap. Jesus has filled the gap. We stand in Christ and pray for the burdens, for all that he lays upon our hearts. Okay, we're not here to just do our own thing or just to fulfill an obligation. We are here to pray according to what the Lord wants for each one of us. We're sharing in his ministry and we're doing it in the power of the Holy Spirit. It is the Holy Spirit who is perfecting every one of our prayers. None of us is praying perfect prayers when we pray in English or in Hindi or any other known language. Our prayers are always limited. Our prayers and our understanding is always, lacking in some way or the other, because we don't have the full picture. That is why we rely on the Holy Spirit, and we take our role as intercessors very seriously. We're not here because we have nothing better to do. We are here because we know God has called us to be here. Therefore, we are serious about what we do. Therefore, we are sincere about what we do. And we are totally dependent on the Holy Spirit. Remembering continually Romans 8, 26 and 27. The Holy Spirit is there to help us in our weakness. And our greatest weakness, dear brothers and sisters, is the fact that we do not know how to pray as we ought. The Word of God tells us that we are no good at praying. We don't know how to pray. We don't know what to pray for. We don't know what words to use. Whatever we use on our own is not enough, is insufficient. That is why the Holy Spirit's, one of the primary ministries of the Holy Spirit is to pray in us, for us, with us, through us, and from us. Okay, let me repeat that. The Holy Spirit is there to pray in us, with us, for us, through us, and from us. Okay, we are the temple of the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit prays from within us. We are the God's headquarters. He lives here within our hearts. And from here, the Holy Spirit, from within our spirits, the Holy Spirit makes petition for us. And the Holy Spirit is not just praying. The Holy Spirit is praying the perfect prayers, groaning out those prayers which are beyond words, which are truly, truly beyond words, which no words can express. No human language can express. And this is the prayer which is pleasing to the Father, because the Father knows all hearts. He knows our hearts. He knows the hearts of those we are praying for. And he has a will for them. He has a will for us. He has a desire, the perfect plan for everyone. And the Holy Spirit ensures that we are praying out that perfect will of God. As this scripture says, as this version says, for the Spirit pleads for us believers in harmony with God's own will. Isn't that beautiful? There's alignment with the will of God. There's harmony with the will of God. Therefore, we know our prayers are perfect, heard, and answered every time. So all we need to do is keep yielding to the Holy Spirit. Let the Holy Spirit groan in us and through us and from us. So let's pray more in tongues. Let's pray more in the Spirit. Throughout the day, keep on allowing the Spirit to pray in you and through you so that this time of intercession will truly, truly be very, very fruitful for each one of us. And this is the beginning of the year. I'm sure we all have made New Year resolutions. If you have already made these as your resolutions, wonderful. But in case you haven't made them, please add these to your resolutions. Decide to pray more in tongues. Decide to pray longer in tongues. Decide to yield more to the Holy Spirit by praying in tongues. Because Ephesians 6:18 says, keep on praying in the Spirit. That's very, very important. If it wasn't so important, St. Paul would not have commanded the Ephesian church to do that. And that is the Holy Spirit reminding us to keep on praying. Pray more in tongues. And in every situation, take authority. Take charge of the situation in the name of Jesus. Now there is a new virus. There is a new strain of the virus. Don't just, you know, behave like everybody else. Take charge. Take authority in the name of Jesus. Bind and cast it out. Bind and command it to die in the name of Jesus. You do it. Don't wait for someone else to do it. Because all of us need to get involved. All of us need to, you know, take it seriously. Every one of us needs to do our part, because creation is looking to us. All people are looking to us. And we as the church need to arise, need to step in and make that difference. For it's only through us, that the answer, the solution to this pandemic is going to be seen, is going to be found. Let's take this very seriously. And this time of intercession, dear brothers and sisters, is a time to intercede for others. It's not, although we have a little time in the end for personal petitions, don't make that your motive for coming here. Oh, I can place my family. I can pray for my job situation. I can pray for my child. I can pray for my spouse. As important as those things are, those you can pray even otherwise. Here's a time where you can make a difference by making a prayer. When the leader of the intercession is asking someone to pray, you be that one. Why don't you be that one? Volunteer to make a prayer. Our prayers are not perfect. It doesn't matter. We have the Holy Spirit who's perfecting them. It's okay if your prayer is one sentence. It doesn't matter. Because anyway, our prayers are not, you know, not the ultimate. The Holy Spirit is the one who is the ultimate at praying, and the Holy Spirit will perfect our prayers. So make that your resolution in this new year. You know, I'm going to make a prayer. At least once a week, I will be one of those who's going to come forward to make a prayer. Before someone else comes, I will make a prayer. Decide to do that. Decide to do that, then you will easily do that. Especially if you have never volunteered to make a prayer of intercession, please do that in this year. It will make all the difference. It will make all the difference. Okay? We need to be bold, dear brothers and sisters. We need to be bold. We're not here just praying. Okay? We are called to be witnesses to Christ. If we don't have the courage to step out and make one prayer, how will we speak about Jesus tomorrow? In our country, where persecution is becoming a harsh reality. If we are hesitant to pray in the company of believers, how are we going to speak about Jesus anywhere else? And Jesus came down very harshly. He said, if you are ashamed of me before men, I will be ashamed of you before my Father in heaven. So here's a time, here's a place where you can get over all shyness and you know, any kind of self-consciousness. This is not a time to think about ourselves. This is a time we are here for ministry, to think about others, to think about their needs. And therefore, it's time for us to be bold, to be adventurous, to be willing to do what we have not done in the last few years of our life. Okay? So, in general, brothers and sisters, when we come into a time of intercession, this is what St. Paul urges us to do, especially in this present time, in this present day, where the church all over the world is experiencing persecution in one form or the other. And we are called as intercessors, as St. Paul reminds Timothy. He says in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1, he says, I urge them, first of all, that petitions, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for all people. We don't really thank for everybody, do we? We pray for people, we make petitions, we intercede for them. We hardly ever thank God for all people, all who we are praying for. Let's do it with a heart of thanksgiving. Let's do it with a heart of thanksgiving. Every person is a gift of God. So when we come to intercede, let's also, apart from praying, interceding, let's also thank God for every person whom he has, given during this time to live as our contemporaries in this world. And let's pray for them. Let's pray for them. And St. Paul, in the next two verses, he says, this is good and is pleasing in the sight of God our Savior. That we pray for others is pleasing to God. So this time of intercession, dear brothers and sisters, is a time when you and I are here to please God. To please God. That's why we need to forget about ourselves and think about only pleasing Him. God, the pleasing in the sight of God, our Savior, who desires all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. How will they come to the knowledge of the truth if no one prays for them? If no one prays for them, before the gospel reaches the ends of the earth, our prayers or petition and intercession must go there to pave the way, to prepare the hearts, so that when the gospel reaches them, they will be able to receive it. They will be able to receive it. That the gospel, the word of God, will not fall on rocky soil, will not be eaten up by the birds, that the devil will not snatch the gospel out of their hearts. But our prayer will go ahead to soften their hearts so that they will receive the gospel when they hear it. That is why we are called to do our intercession. We are called to be faithful to this and pray faithfully that all people will be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. The truth is that Jesus alone is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through Him. And this is the truth that we are called to proclaim, that God so loved the world that He gave us His only Son. And whoever believes in Him will be saved. Whoever does not believe is condemned already. It's already condemned. The world, the whole world, the unbelieving world is already under a sentence of condemnation, is under a death sentence. It is for us, brothers and sisters, to reach out, to pray for the salvation of the world and to be willing to proclaim whenever we have an opportunity. So the general will of God is this, that all be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. And specifically, as the Spirit leads us, St. Paul is reminding Timothy once again, the same chapter, the same first few verses. In verse 2, he says, pray this way for kings and all who are in authority. Brothers and sisters, this is very, very important in our day, in our time, when those who are in authority are using their power and their position against the church, against the Christian world. Therefore, we need to pray for them with a deep sense of burden and responsibility so that we can all live peaceful and quiet lives marked by godliness and dignity. That our rights will be protected, that we'll be able to freely proclaim the gospel. We're not interested in forcing anyone. We're not interested in forcing anyone. That's not our job. What do we want to do? We want to be able to live peaceful, quiet lives marked by godliness and dignity. Nobody should be able to suppress us. We should be able to freely proclaim Christ so that our lives are lived in godliness and dignity, that our rights are not thwarted. But these are trying times, brothers and sisters. These are really harsh times. And, you know, persecution is a harsh reality. All of us are facing it in one form or the other. In our country, in the last few weeks, we have been praying for persecuted countries all over the world. And it is time. It is time for us to realize that persecution is really, really rampant in our world. Therefore, we need to rise. Because threats by people in authority are becoming more blatant, more bold, because they're using their power to suppress the gospel, to suppress the church, to suppress Christians, which is not what they're called to do. And yet they're doing it. They're doing it. So what are we called to do? We are called to rise up too and start getting very focused, targeted. We need to not, you know, just pray general prayers. We need to start being very specific. And this is what I want to share in this time. And I feel the Lord has, laid this burden upon my heart to share with every one of you that we need to get specific. In Acts chapter 4, verse 29, when they were faced with persecution, this is how the early church prayed. And now, Lord, look upon their threats. Who are they talking about? The Pharisees, the Sanhedrin, the Sadducees all came against the baby church and were trying to thwart the church with threats saying, don't proclaim the name of Jesus. And how did the church pray? How did the early church pray? Led by the Holy Spirit. Continue to make your servants continue to speak your word with all boldness. They did not say, you know, Lord, help us, you know, protect us and just keep us safe. No. He said, we know they are threatening us. We know they're coming against us, but help us to be bold and continue to speak your word with all boldness. This is the way we ought to pray in this time, brothers and sisters. Pray for courage, pray for boldness, pray for strength. We're called to pray just as the early church prayed, because we have the same Holy Spirit, not to give in to fear, but to be bold in love so that we continue to do what we are called to do. And in this time, let us pray in a very focused way for our persecutors. I sense the Lord is, very specifically the Holy Spirit gave me a burden to pray for one person who is, standing very prominently in our city of Bangalore, and breathing threats against the church, trying to force Christians of the past generations to be reconverted. He's young, and he reminds me so much of Paul, who was such a persecutor of the church. And I have decided, I have adopted him. I'm sure he's much younger than me. I have adopted him as my younger brother, who I'm going to pray for. And in the same way, brothers and sisters, ask the Holy Spirit to give you a burden for any one particular person. Maybe they are very prominent national, international figures. But if you know that they are persecuting the church in one way or the other, if that is the person the Holy Spirit is showing you today, adopt that person. Adopt that person. Pray daily in tongues. And we're going to do very specific things. Pray daily in tongues for 3 minutes for this person to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. That this person will come to know Jesus as their personal Savior, as their personal Redeemer and Lord. Pray very specifically for that one person. I mean, it's good to pray generally, but it's time to pray very specifically too. What else? Fast. If you feel you need to fast and pray for their salvation. Make sacrifices for this intention. Do whatever you feel the Holy Spirit is urging you to do. And during this time of intercession, if there are any of the intercessors, the leaders, the animators, I request you to kindly, you know, during this time of intercession, we will, without mentioning any names, we will just say, okay, we are going to pray for the person whom God has, when the Holy Spirit has asked us to pray for. And we pray for 1 minute in tongues. No names mentioned, no reasons, everyone knows. Every one of us knows what we are praying for, who we are praying for, and most of all, God knows. And He is going to touch the hearts and transform them, and we are going to see the fruit of it. We will see the fruit of our intercession very, very soon. If you pray in this very, very specific, focused way, and this is what is going to happen, brothers and sisters. Acts chapter 9, verse 31. The church then had peace. This is after the conversion of Saul. After his conversion, the church then had peace throughout Judea, Galilee, and Samaria. And it became stronger as the believers lived in the fear of the Lord. And with the encouragement, with the comfort, with the strength of the Holy Spirit, it also grew in numbers. Yes, the church does grow during persecution. But it also grows mightily, marvelously during times of mercy and God's favor. So let us pray for an end to the persecution and see our church grow and increase in numbers, just the way it did in the Acts of the Apostles. This happened after the conversion of Saul. And he became such an amazing apostle of the Lord. So that when we pray for these people, we must pray that they too will become like Saul, who became Paul. That's what we want to see, so that the church will grow, that the kingdom of God will flourish here on earth. This happened in a very, very significant way when Emperor Constantine became a Christian. And after decades, after hundreds of years of persecution, the church became the official, the Christianity became the official recognized religion of the Roman Empire. And peace came. Peace came all around. Brothers and sisters, let us pray for this. Let us pray for this. The church has been going through times of persecution for decades now, for centuries in its own way. In so many countries, persecution has been a harsh reality. For centuries, the gospel has not been freely proclaimed. For centuries, we have to rise, pray specifically, and see this. Maybe you're concerned about that indifferent family member, about your spouse probably, your son, your daughter, maybe your non-Christian friend or neighbor during this year. Maybe you can include that one person and pray very specifically for their salvation. Do the same things. Do the same things. 3 minutes of praying in tongues in your time of personal prayer, in your time of personal intercession. What a difference it's going to make. What a difference it's going to make. The Holy Spirit will work powerfully. And if you believe for that person's salvation, love them. Show how much you love them by praying sincerely for them. Let's do this. Let's do this in a very, very targeted way and get the amazing results that the Holy Spirit is going to see through us. And we are called not to give up. Let's persevere. Let's fight the good fight of the faith. Let's fight to win. Because we are more than conquerors. Victory is already ours, for the battle is the Lord's. Therefore, dear brothers and sisters, I want to urge every one of you, take this as a clarion call from the Lord, you know, and adopt that one, you know, prominent figure. Maybe in your own country, your city, your state, you know, anyone the Lord is laying on your heart, and pray specifically and see the victory. In the mighty and the matchless name of Jesus, amen. Praise God.